walking along the street, or you're at a party, or else you're alone, and then you suddenly dig. You're looking in someone's eyes, you suddenly realize that this could be the start of something big.
The middle of the 1950s was a complicated and very much transitional period in the music industry. Just a few years before, the big band of the previous decade had given way to a more generic and popular vocal sound as things were speeding towards the onset of rock and roll and the British invasion. Despite establishing a career which stretched more than 50 years, Steve Lawrence and Eydie Gormé are two performers who were fully and completely associated with this era of the music industry. They were just a few years too young to dominate when their skill sets would have truly fit the time, but unfortunately just a bit too old to quite gel with where things were going into the 1950s. However, despite everything, they carved themselves out a heck of a run, and they did it on their own terms.
Love and marriage, love and marriage, go together like a horse and carriage.
You know, Steve, I always love that song because it has a happy approach to marriage.
It sure does, but you know, the lyrics leave out the part about changing baby diapers at 2 o'clock in the morning, and the checking account being overdrawn and taking out the garbage.
Garbage? You haven't taken out the garbage in the 10 years we've been married.
I haven't?
No. You better do it tomorrow. It's really piled up.
Why don't you just put it in the freezer like you do everything else? But you know, marriage can be an awful lot of fun. It really can.
While they're perhaps best known as a couple, Steve and Eydie both started out as single acts. Each had their own career, their own successes, and really their own lives.
I sacrificed anything, come what might, for the sake of having you near. Spite of a warning voice that comes in the night and repeats in my ear. Don't you know, little fool, you never can win. Use your mentality, wake up to reality. But each time I do, just the thought of you makes me stop before I begin. I've got you under my skin.
Oh, my lover, when you want me, call me in the hush of the evening. When you call me in the hush of the evening, I'll rush to my first real romance.
Direct examination of Eydie Gormé in particular shows the battles a woman had to fight during this period to be taken seriously, as well as society's desire to pigeonhole a woman into a certain role. However, as we've looked at before, it's never that simple. Chances are, if you remember the mid-60s or are a sucker for all things nostalgic like me, you know who Steve and Eydie are. The couple are perhaps best known for their variety show appearances throughout the 1960s as a double act after...
But you said try just once more. I chose you for the one. Now I'm having so much fun. You treated me so kind. I'm about to lose my mind. You made me so very happy. I'm so glad you came into my life.
Thank you, baby. Others weren't true,
sad but true.
But when it came to loving you,
here's your cue.
I'd spend my whole life with you. As you came and you took control,
I know.
You touched my very soul,
I know.
You always showed me that,
I know.
Loving you was where it's at. Cause you made me so very happy. I'm so glad you to my life. I love.
First making a name for themselves on the initial run of the Steve Allen Tonight Show in the middle of the 1950s.
You're walking along the street, or you're at a party,
or else you're alone, and then you suddenly dig.
You're looking at someone's eyes, you suddenly realize that this could be the start of something big.
Lunching at Romanov's and watching your diet, declining a Charlotte Russe, accepting a fig.
When out of a clear blue sky, it's suddenly gallant guy,
and this could be the start of something big.
There's no controlling the unrolling of your fate, my friend.
Who knows what's written in the magic book?
But when a lover you discover at the gate, my friend,
invite her in without a second look.
You're up on a mountain top, or dining at Chasen's, or lying at Malibu alone on the sand. You suddenly hear a bell, and right away you can tell that this could be the start of something grand.
A destined lover you'll discover in a brightening flash. So keep your heart awake both night and day, because the meeting may be fleeting as a lightning flash,
and you don't want to let it slip away.
You're watching the sun come up, or counting your money, or else in a dim cafe you're ordering wine.
Steve Allen shot to popularity in the early years of TV as a local television host. However, the market was ripe for young talent, and the Renaissance man Allen was a great fit. The songwriter, comedian, and presenter worked steadily throughout the next couple of decades and helped to jumpstart the careers of people like Stephen Eadie, Andy Williams, Tom Poston, and Don Knotts. It was during this period, 1957 to be exact, that Stephen Eadie tied the knot at the El Rancho Hotel in Las Vegas. Eydie Gormé was born Edith Gormanzano in 1928, and according to her NPR obituary, her family spoke Ladino, described as a variant of Old Spanish. This proved to be vitally important to her career in a number of ways. In fact, according to The Guardian, she worked as a UN interpreter after graduating from high school in 1946. At the same time, she was trudging towards her own break in the music industry. She started out singing with big bands, Tommy Tucker and Tex Beneke, according to The Guardian. This article dates as part of her career to around 1950. Unfortunately, the heyday of the big bands had been a few years earlier. Names like Glenn Miller and Benny Goodman are still familiar today. Frank Sinatra had even gotten his big break singing with the Tommy Dorsey Orchestra. However, by the 1950s, things had already started to shift as the industry began to celebrate individual vocalists in place of entire orchestras. Following with the times, Gormé started making a national name for herself, getting on television, and she was also cultivating her own solo career at this time. She earned her biggest hit in the United States charts with Blame It on the Bossa Nova.
Blame it on the Bossa Nova, with its magic spell.
The song reached the top 10 in the United States and secured Gormé a Grammy nomination for Best Female Pop Vocal Performance of 1964. Unfortunately, the award that year was given to Barbra Streisand. Throughout the mid-60s, the music industry in the United States took a hard left turn, thanks to these guys. While her career with Lawrence continued, Gormé continued advancing and evolving her own singing career. During the middle of the 1950s, she made a number of Spanish language albums, Amor, Mon Amor, and Navidad Means Christmas.
Muchos más, yo no sé si tenga amor, ya ni nada, pero hay algo como aquí en la boca llevarás sabor a mí.
Each album hit the charts and led to Gormé finally earning a Grammy Award in 1966 for If He Walked Into My Life.
Was there too much of a crowd? All too lush and loud? Make the same mistakes if he walked into my life today.
Over the span of her career, despite her success as a solo artist, Gormé struggles to stand out as an independent performer in her own right. The media of the period is quick to stake her identity simply as Mrs. Steve Lawrence. In an April 1964 profile on her husband, author John Wilson writes, Lawrence's success in Sammy's temporarily stymied the nightclub career of his partner, Mrs. Lawrence. She is, however, occupied as wife and mother to their two sons and mistress of their New York apartment. On the side, she still does make records and does occasional television appearance. This article makes her career sound like a bridge hobby.
All right, as you know, panel, we go to a different form of questioning, one question at a time, in turn, moving clockwise. We'll begin with Steve Lawrence.
Are you in the entertainment industry?
Yes.
Miss Kilgallen?
What was that?
That was a yes.
Are you a singer? Yes.
Mr. Cerf?
Are you appearing now or about to appear in a Broadway musical show?
No.
One down and nine to go, Miss Francis.
Are you appearing now or are you about to appear in a New York club or hotel?
No.
Two down and eight to go, Mr. Lawrence.
Are you currently in a motion picture playing here on Broadway?
No.
Three down and seven to go, Miss Kilgallen.
Sounds like you're out of work.
Wait a minute.
What?
Say who it is.
Say who it is. Is it somebody, are you the mother of my children? I'm still trying to think who it is. You told me to get out of the house early tonight.
Okay. You know, the other wonderful part about it is this.
Who's watching the children?
When Steve left the house, Eydie was hanging over the kitchen sink, washing the dishes, and the hair is down.
And he kept saying, why do you want me to get out of here so early? I said, it's not. They called and said you had to be there at 9 o'clock. He said, but they never wanted me there at 9 o'clock before. I said, Steve, you're going to do a show, do it right. Otherwise, don't do it at all.
Earlier in the same article, she's described as having some reputation in records and nightclubs. Other articles openly toy with her age. Gormé was 7 years older than her husband, and these often make her younger than he is. While the motivations are a little murkier here, why does her age always change while his stays the same? Is it a product of the media of the era not wanting to see an older woman marrying a younger man? Could her PR have simply just been lying about her age? It's difficult to say. Even in her NPR obituary, the article takes a strange stance on her career, saying, but if you say you're a fan of Gormé, if it doesn't get you a blank stare, it will get you a quizzical look, because Gormé was not cool. She didn't even try. And this is supposed to be an attribute. Thankfully, the article takes a step off its high horse to quote jazz critic Will Friedwald. Eydie Gormé certainly deserves respect. She's one of the greatest interpreters of the American songbook. It's a big, rich, beautiful, and deep voice that has phenomenal tonal range, but emotional range as well. However, despite all the roadblocks the media seems to want to put between them, the most progressive ally Gormé had was in her husband. In the above article, Lawrence responds to the John Wilson quotation by saying, "For a housewife, she makes a hell of a living." He was always his wife's biggest supporter, being quoted after her 2013 passing and saying, "I fell in love with her the moment I saw her, and even more the first time I heard her sing. The world has lost one of the greatest pop vocalists of all time."
Someday you figure will start to spread.
Your fallen arches will drop like lead.
You'll find your beautiful smile has fled.
No hair atop of your shiny head.
Don't let the wrinkles upset you. I'll still be happy I met you.
Darn it, baby, that's love. Someday you're gonna lose your physique.
We'll have the doctor in twice a week.
My chic will suddenly grow antique.
You'll be so deaf that I'll have to shriek.
Though you're a physical wreck, dear, I'll still be happy the next year. Darn it, baby, that's love. That's love, that's love.
We might as well be sensible.
That's love, that's love. To me he's indispensable.
You'll be a psychoneurotic case.
Too old to leave me a merry chance.
Too fat to give me a warm embrace.
Hot water bottles may take my place.
No doubt I'll still want a pitcher.
That's out, your gal wouldn't let you.
Well, it's me for you.
This is how we need to remember Eydie Gormé and in turn her partnership with husband Steve Lawrence. While society is so quick to pigeonhole the duo as square examples of a not cool era of music, Eydie Gormé was a talented and multi-layered performer who carved out a long-running career spanning a variety of mediums, and she did it her way. Stay tuned for more here at Female Gaze Productions as we look at classic pop culture through a historical and feminist lens. My name is Kim. You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at KatePierce624. And as always, if you like what you're seeing, please like and subscribe. Thanks, guys.